coming back to Purdue Pharma, right? The arch villain of the opioid crisis. Over the last year, we've seen quite a few actually like legal actions and settlements with different opioid manufacturers just in September. So Purdue Pharma basically declared bankruptcy. And then just in September, I believe a bankruptcy court dissolved the company and, you know, forced them to negotiate a settlement, which was basically a one-time payout where they would, you know, give some cash to sort of distribute and compensate among the families and people who had been affected by the opioid crisis. So on the one hand, you know, it's like, well, I guess that's better than nothing. They're not completely off the hook. On the other hand, you know, part of the deal was that they're now shielded from further litigation. And of course, they're still rich. So, you know, was it a huge win? Debatable. And then the other thing is, you know, as we've just been talking about, the opioid crisis has evolved so much to the point where it's now a fentanyl crisis that in a way the Sacklers like almost seem obsolete. Like I said this earlier to Ariella and like, you know, to be clear, like I still think that, you know, the state should seize their fortune and they should be banished from public life, you know, but at the same time, like, I guess the question for both of you actually is like, where do we go after the Sacklers?
Could I answer that real quick with reference to an article that I did not write, but I edited, because that's what I'm doing now for Jacobin for the most part. There's an article that I edited by Ryan Zitgraf. It was published just earlier this month. It's called "The Opioid Crisis Hasn't Gone Away; It's Just Gone Underground." That takes up this exact question. I think that that's a very good point, and I think people should think about it, because I think the left, it's almost like we're playing catch up, and we're just now getting our talking points together on the Sacklers. And the truth of the matter is that we've moved on to the third wave of the. I mean, that's the supposedly the first wave of the opioid crisis. We're just now figuring out how the first and second wave fit together, which is the, you know, legal pharmaceutical opioid crisis and like the street heroin crisis. And we need to be like catching up to the fentanyl crisis now. Easier said than done. I don't think the left is great on like drug policy stuff, self extremely included. I feel like I'm always playing catch up with this. But it's worth going and reading Ryan Zitgraf's piece, which is a review of a book by Sam Quinones called The Least of Us, True Tales of America and Hope in the Time of Fentanyl and Meth, which just came out. Sam Quinones is the author of Dreamland, The True Tale of America's Opiate Epidemic, which was a book that he was shopping around prior to 2015 and nobody would publish, apparently, because people didn't understand that this was like a real thing that people were going to want to talk about. This article is good for a variety of reasons. I'll let you guys read it and form your own conclusions, but I do want to highlight one aspect of it, which is Ryan's, I think, really insightful observation that essentially the capitalism is still driving the opioid crisis in the United States. It's just that instead of the big capitalists right now, the major driver of the opioid crisis, in particular of overdose deaths, is actually the petty bourgeoisie, the black market petty bourgeoisie, and not the grand capitalists. It's kind of moved into the underground. And you know, your problem right now, unfortunately, people like the Sackler. I mean, Ariel did a great job explaining why there's still a problem emanating from the actual legitimate grand bourgeoisie of this country. It's just that they've been joined by black market petty bourgeois drug dealers in pumping poison. And the actions of the former have actually created a lot of space for the actions of the latter to like have, you know, bigger bang for their buck, essentially. And so this problem just keeps compounding and compounding, and capitalism is at the root of all of it. But it is actually quite interesting in my view that whereas you used to have, you know, people in suits with, you know, private jets and the highest paid lawyers in the land, now they're joined essentially in continuing to create this problem on a regular basis by, you know, just you're like, I'm not talking about like low level street drug dealers. These are not the people that I'm pinning this on, but like, you know, they're being joined by essentially,
it's cartel leaders.
Yeah. It's cartel leaders. They're cartel leaders. They're entrepreneurs.
Those people are capitalists.
Yes, yeah. They are. And actually, I want to just like, as an aside, while we're talking about this, I don't know if this bothers you, but the kind of like ethos sometimes on the left of like, you know, like the anti-state, anti-authoritarian ethos sometimes leads to a logical logical conclusion that like to do crime is somehow like a big fuck you to the man. It's like, okay, mm-hmm. actually, if you look at the literal structure of cartels, they are exploitative capitalist enterprises. They're just not legally regulated. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so we're not on, that's not cool. They're not like giving the fuck you to the cops or whatever. It's like right. they are yeah. doing poisonous capitalism, just like the Sacklers. Mm-hmm. And so that is, and in many cases, I mean, you've also got your sort of, you've got like kind of like rise and grind hustle culture in the black market economy yeah. as well. You've got a lot of like petty bourgeois mm-hmm. entrepreneurs who are like trying to find a
business
way.
Business is a business. You're really, yeah. You're not like escaping into like a nicer, friendlier kind of like business world. These people are also capitalists and they're operating on a global level often, and they're moving product and they're trying to also create demand for it. So they're lacing every possible drug with fentanyl yep. because you get a repeat consumer instead of having a one-time consumer. A lot of the information that I got about this is from Sam Quinones's book. And I love the article that you edited and that you were citing earlier. It's a great review of some of his work, but he also is an anti-capitalist. And he's like, these issues, you know, it's a different arithmetic to create a product that gets people biologically hooked on that product. And it is monstrous. It's monstrous. Like they really, really don't care on either side, legal or illegal. And you're not talking at this moment about like a small time person who's like, I'm gonna sell some of my extra pills to afford other prescriptions, which is a story that I read when I was researching my piece. You're talking about people who are operating on a massive level, who are really essentially running a business enterprise that's just not sanctioned by the state. I also think that there's this kind of under-discussed, I don't know. So like, I like the line of logic that comes out of thinking about deaths of despair. And there's this rat study where they, it's kind of an infamous rat study where they give rats drugs. And the rats that are like in a horrible, horrible cage are like, no, I'm only doing drugs now. Like they refuse food, you know, they don't care. They get hooked. The rats that are in a rat paradise where they have lovely different types of foods, things that rats love, different textures, stuff to gnaw on, sexual partners, a social life, those rats don't want the drugs. And I think that, you know, that may be an oversimplification of some of the logic behind this, but really like when you talk about pain, people are treating mental and emotional and physical pain. We have a country of people who have untreated medical conditions, who die from untreated medical conditions, who turn to the internet and friends and family for treatment and care because they can't get it from medical experts. And that creates a completely different landscape, right? When you're then going in and saying, hey, I've got this miracle product and it's cheap and you can get it without prior authorization and there's no hoops to jump through. And then we also have a nation of people who can't just walk in and have free treatment like at the time of service. So you can go into a clinic with Medicaid and you have to wait and get prior approval for addiction treatment. But you have a state that will absolutely wreck your life, right? If you slip up and get part of the criminal system. And so beyond it just being unfair and like, you know, wrong, morally wrong, it also changes the stakes of interaction and compounds already existing issues of social anxiety and a feeling of precarity. So not only do you have the kind of just regular kind of material unfairness, you also have this psychological drive where people's lives are unstable, unfair, and they're like, anything can be taken from me at a moment's notice, economically, my family. If I get caught up in the wheels of the state, I may disappear. I may not see my kids again. When I was pregnant, I was looking at information about cesareans, and I found a mommy blog that was like, if you get a cesarean, then you can't essentially come up positive on a drug test for opioids because they give them to you during the surgery. And it was these women talking about how they felt like this was a way for them to keep their kids because they could use the cesarean to mask a drug addiction that they couldn't get treated. Like, that's where we are, you know?
Wow.
It is extremely grim. And that creates a kind of ecosystem and a mood. I think you said this in one of your pieces, Meagan, that you quoted somebody who was like, it casts a shadow over this entire town. How does a person, you know, have hope or want to be engaged when they feel like that's their world?
I want to talk about the mood a little bit before we move on to, I mean, this is probably the least perhaps like strictly materialist thing that I'm gonna offer you today, but like, I don't know how you guys feel. I don't know how old you guys are. I'm 33, so that means that when I was in high school, I don't know, maybe you guys were in the same high school at the same time as me. I feel like the party culture was like
we were.
Okay, I feel like the party culture was like red solo cups and like Andrew WK party hard, and it was like really hype. Like it was
that, what a throwback.
That's what it meant to like get fucked up. Like, teenagers have been getting fucked up forever, but like that's what it felt like. That's what it was. That was the high that you were chasing, was essentially like a very, very stupid communal form of ecstasy. And I actually think that the long drawn out three waves of the opioid crisis have had a major impact beyond just you know, intentional opioid or opiate users. I feel personally like I can observe that in the entire culture, I think that there's some causality here, that to be a party person is to be chasing oblivion, like to be chasing a sort of like dark numbness. You can hear it in the music, you can see it in the party drugs that are popular. And, you know, I don't know, maybe there's a chicken and egg thing and we can get into like all of the causality. But personally, I do perceive that. And I have some personal experience with this, which is that my brother, who was 17 at the time, overdosed late last year. He's disabled now, both cognitively and physically, permanently, most likely. And one of the substances that it was a multi-substance overdose. And one of them was an opioid, but another was a benzo and another was just alcohol. And, you know, he wasn't like an opioid user. He was a 17-year-old kid who went to parties. And that's the kind of thing that 17-year-old kids who go to parties do now. And I do feel like that's an after effect of the general cultural changes that have occurred in the context of the broader opioid crisis. So I feel like, you know, I have some personal experience with that, which is actually what drove me to write the story about the two young men to begin with, actually, because the brain injury that my brother got from his overdose is actually quite common in people who survive overdoses. And Max had the same brain injury. So I met his dad on a Facebook group for family members who are dealing with this. And this Facebook group is full of people who are loved ones of survivors of overdoses who have brain injuries, which is actually something that you don't hear about very often. I think you're going to be hearing about it more, because I think that fentanyl in particular leads to this kind of brain injury if it doesn't kill you pretty often. I had not really heard of it, actually. Frankly, I hadn't heard of that until it happened to someone in my family. But my point is that like I think that there are reverberations beyond people who know that they're doing drugs that might contain, that either are opiate or opioid, or that they might contain synthetic opioids. There are reverberations throughout our entire culture. I think that it's very closely implicated to a kind of depressive mood in the culture, which I perceive punctuated by like moments of mania, sometimes mania, like when we're all rallying to like get Bernie elected, sometimes frightening mania, like, you know, the various visions of like whatever, like QAnon and you know, January 6th or whatever. But like, you know, it does feel like it feels like a manic depressive moment to me. And I think that more depressive than manic, punctuated sporadically by manias, but the depressive atmosphere feels very linked to the opioid crisis to me. And it has reverberations well beyond people who know that they are in the line of fire for something like a fentanyl overdose.
If you like this video from The Jacobin Show, please hit like and subscribe and share with your friends. Thanks.